expired, but the problems remain. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Inside Out with me, Susan Madaris. The recent debate over whether or not to extend unemployment coverage into the new year has resulted in its discontinuation as of December 28th for 1.3 million jobless Americans. Across the country, many volunteer groups and nonprofit organizations have been doing their best to mitigate poverty's impact on their city and neighborhood's population. New York is no exception. One group in particular, Muslims Giving Back, has been hard at work to give as much aid as possible to those in need. On this edition of Inside Out, we join them on their weekly run and bring you an up-close and personal account of the challenges those on the street face, not only the homeless, but the groups helping them. All that and more on this edition of Inside Out. It's a cold and wet night here in New York. The city is just starting to recover from the gripping wrath of the polar vortex. The large pocket of cold air which brought to New York 118-year record low temperatures. Air, road, and rail travels were halted, energy prices hiked, and shelters for the homeless were overwhelmed. New York has its fair share of homeless population. Roughly 60,000 people spend a night at a shelter here, including 22,000 children, the highest number since the Great Depression. However, during the winter months, many are left to cope on the streets.
When I first came, you know, to the street for us, when I first became homeless, it was real rough. Because I didn't know nothing about being homeless. I didn't know where to go or where to sleep or, you know, where I'm going to get my next food from.
Didn't think it'd be that hard to live in a mission, any kind of a mission or shelter, but it is. It's just too scary for me. I'd rather sleep outside. If it's 20 below, 30 below, I just get enough blankets or enough equipment just to roll up around myself.
Tonight, I joined one of the few groups who takes a hand-on approach in tackling the hunger epidemic gripping New York. Muslims Giving Back helps by providing necessary goods and services to impoverished communities in New York City. Their programs ensure that people in need not only receive food, but clothing and even shelter. Twice a week, they make stops at a few locations across the city.
What we do is every Friday and Saturday nights, we try to hit the same locations that are like a hotbed where the homeless usually gather.
Right.
So this is one location, Madison Square Park.
Right.
So we try to start around 10:45, 11 and keep it consistent. As you can see, even though the weather is raining and cold, there is going to be a few people. Okay. I mean, when the weather was better back in August, September, you would see about 20, 30, 40, sometimes 50 people here just waiting, sometimes sleeping in the car. So a lot of the times they're looking for certain necessities like food, socks, coats and jackets, so we try to carry everything in one shop. So today we usually come with about 100 meals ready to go, cooked at home, like freshly made.
Oh, okay.
So every week we give out about 200 meals.
Wow, so yeah. you have hot meals right now?
Yeah, it's hot meals.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What is it?
It's vegetarian, so it's like rice, beans, lentils, okay, and everything. Because there are other organizations that come also and give out the food, but we've noticed that they don't give anything like a hot meal. It's usually like a peanut butter jelly sandwich or like processed salami and cheese. So we try to do something different and really, you know, give them something fresh that we cook. And that meal was just cooked like an hour ago.
Throughout the five boroughs, approximately 1.4 million people, mainly women, children, seniors, the working poor, and people with disabilities, rely on soup kitchens and food pantries. Approximately 2.6 million New Yorkers experience difficulty affording food for themselves and their families. With food prices steadily rising, struggling New Yorkers' ability to buy food for themselves and their families is at a crisis level. To make matters worse, approximately 3 million New Yorkers live in low-income neighborhoods, that lack access to affordable, nutritious food. With their budgets already strained and the prevalence of low-cost, low-quality food in these neighborhoods, these residents face significant challenges in maintaining a healthy lifestyle, leading to high concentrations of diet-related conditions such as diabetes, obesity, and hypertension. Earlier in the day, I had met up with Garrett Bryant, the national spokesman for Muslims Giving Back.
The grounds of Macy's are flooded with homeless people every night, every day. We see that every time we go out to feed people. Mm-hmm. Literally right across the street from one of the most powerful businesses on the planet who makes billions of dollars, untold billions of dollars, these people are outside of their store and they can't afford anything that's in the store. Mm-hmm. This is indicative of the pathology of consumerism in our nation and the pathology of indifference and the pathology of carelessness towards our fellow citizenry.
Brian says his organization wrote a letter to the office of Bill de Blasio, New York's new mayor, asking him to join them on just one of their tours.
He never responded. So, you know what I'm saying? So for an organization that's actually on the ground petitioning politicians or politicians to be, to see what we do and to try to get a scope of how the city that they plan to administer is functioning, and they don't show up or they don't respond, that says a lot.
Gareth knows how it feels to be homeless.
I have firsthand experience of what it's like to experience the bitter harshness of homelessness in a New York City winter. So I know exactly how that feels. And the people that we service and the people that we see on the street, I've been where they are. Not necessarily to the same severity, but in a general scope, I've been where they are. So me as an individual Muslim, as an individual member of Muslims Giving Back, I take this work very seriously because I've been on the receiving end. So I know how it feels to need and for people to be sincere in their giving. And I try to be, and we try to be, as members of Muslims Giving Back, we try to be very sincere in our giving. Like, we try our best not to give just to show that we're giving. Because there's a difference between enhancing someone's humanity and just giving them a handout.
Today, as he's on the giving end, he says while he tries to not turn anyone away, sometimes they have no other choice.
People do try to scam for just stuff. I mean, that's just a reality. So it's very tedious work for us with the gathering of information process to try to see who's really sincere versus people who are just trying to get over. It's a very gray area. Sometimes it's very hard to decipher who's being sincere and who's the scam artist. It's almost, in certain cases, it's literally impossible to tell the difference. And then in certain cases, it's crystal clear, the difference. So is literally a case-by-case basis.
The group, which has about 30 members and is more than a year old, says it strives to provide empowerment through food aid, education, and community building in all 5 boroughs of New York's tri-state area. But they also hope their efforts on behalf of the Muslim community will do away with Islamophobia, xenophobia, and sexism.
And really our, I guess, sole mission is just to, since we're an Islamic organization, you know, we wanted to bring those values that we believe that are dear in Islam and our faith, like giving back and brotherhood and helping the poor and the needy, out in public. Because New York City here, you know, 13 years ago, an event happened here that changed the world, right? Literally a couple of, minutes down, you know, from like 9/11. So since then, really, people looked at Muslims differently. So the word Muslim has been synonymous with the word terror, right? With the word evil and all this. So we want to really formulate, you know, an organization or a movement to try to take that image away, you know? And the thousands and thousands of Muslims in New York City for the past 12, 13 years hasn't really been that active in public, you know?
So do you think the reason for that is because they're a little intimidated considering the surveillance that's been around Muslims?
Oh yeah, absolutely. The surveillance was a big thing. You know, we ourselves actually last year, we had a surveillance issue. And so when we started, you know, coming up and starting the movement, you know, we're a registered charity and everything, you know, we had an informant amongst us for 4 months. You know, 4 months he was with us, you know. And so what it is actually, the NYPD and the whole JTTF institution put this informant with us to try to monitor and track what we're doing.
So you didn't know about
it? We did not know. Uh-huh. So 4 months, and this guy was with us during the beginning steps of Muslims Giving Back, while we just started, that we started guiding the pantry, we started delivering food to the poor and to the families. So this guy was with us for 4 months in the beginning stages. And actually after a while, after those 4 months, he came out public and saying that, you know, he was informing this whole time, because what happened, the NYPD told him that this group is an extremist group, right? So you're there, you know, you're helping your country by trying to prevent some sort of plot. But after 4 months, he became like a friend with us, right? He came to our homes many times, he slept over a lot of our members' homes, hanging out, and he saw what we were doing for those 4 months. So I guess after that, he said like he felt guilty that, you know, this is not really a group that the NYPD told him who they were.
Their altruism had a price. The disclosure led to a renouncement by their convening mosque, both a meeting place and a source of funds, and a struggle to find adequate financial support to continue organizational programs. The NYPD initially denied it had any involvement. However, after a thorough investigation and evidence put forth by the informant himself, the NYPD admitted it had been involved and the case was closed.
Initially, when it happened, people were very standoffish towards us because they felt, okay, well, if he's infiltrating them, who knows where else he's infiltrating? So it's almost like there was like this cloud over our organization, almost. And it, like I said, it really caused a lot of people to draw back from supporting our organization. So fortunately, we were able to get past that. Yeah. But it could have been a scenario when that could have ruined us. Fortunately, it didn't, but it could have.
With that story behind them, today Muhammad says he's happy to focus on their efforts to help those in need, but also to start breaking stereotypes.
There is two organizations in New York City that feed the homeless on a consistent basis that really come to the streets. One of them is called Midnight Run, which is like a faith-based Christian organization. The second now is us. So we were shocked to actually be in that step. So after a while, you start developing relationships with a lot of these homeless people, and they really start, you start breaking stereotypes. And I think the number one thing that's really shocked, especially like in New York City outside, because they see what we do when we go inside Penn Station while we're outside. Yeah. They're just astonished when they see us. They go, wow, you know, you guys are Muslims and you guys are really doing this. Why you guys are doing this? That's another thing they always ask us, but why and why? Because they think there's like something like, you know, why, you know, it's a Friday night, Saturday night, and most of our members are the youth, right? So why are these young kids staying up till 11, 12, 1 in the morning, right, driving around looking for the homeless, giving them food and everything? So they're always really, fascinated by that image, especially when we have the Muslim woman, you know, the women with our female members with the hijab and everything. They're just astonished. That's something not new for them, because what they're used to seeing is what? You know, like media, how portrays Muslims, right? Like terrorists, so-called, and bombs, and, you know, Muslims are evil and everything. But when they see in real life Muslims doing those kind of acts, they totally get shocked.
We headed to our next stop of the night, Penn Station, a major inner city train station and a commuter rail hub.
A lot of them get kicked out, unfortunately. That's one thing, actually, the past couple of months that we found the greatest obstacle is not really us finding the resources to help the homeless or feed. It's actually been like the authority. So a lot of times, like the police and Port Authority police, that they kick these homeless out. So even like the past couple of days, when it's been like extremely cold, while we're going around, we don't find them anywhere. But when we go inside the train stations, we see the police waking them up and forcing them to go outside.
Once settled by Penn Station, a few of the members go inside to look for the homeless seeking refuge from the cold. Shortly after they arrive, they're asked to leave the station, along with the homeless and our cameras. Meanwhile, outside, crowds gather to receive what they need.
The blankets on your car? Yeah. Can you give one to this guy, please? Follow him, just give him, he'll give you a blanket. At least you could stay warm there if you're gonna sleep on a chair all night.
Oh, and did I mention, there's always dessert.
It's not just a necessity, you need a treat.
Exactly. Right? It's more of like a little gift to like soften them up. Know that there are people out there who bake this specially for them. And they really appreciate that. It's like a little gift, basically.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, who doesn't appreciate that?
Exactly. So that's what the project called Bake a Difference, where every week you know, try to get together and find, like, a couple of months ago, we went by a football team. Mm-hmm. Consists of 5 years old till 9 years old.
Okay.
So after football practice, we went there, we gave them cupcakes, little chocolate milks and everything as treats for the kids. And they're actually all organic-based ingredients and everything, because we try to keep it healthy, too, because a lot of these guys have, you know, sugar problems and everything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we try to keep it balanced and, you know.
While non-governmental organizations and communities try their best to pick up the slack for the benefit of struggling fellow citizens, without efficient, good chance that Washington will finally find a solution to the extension of unemployment benefits, whether it's to the advantage of the Republicans or the Democrats. We'll have to see how the issue pans out. For now, volunteers and nonprofit organizations are picking up the slack. That's all the time we have for this edition of Inside Out. Thanks so much for staying with us and watching. Remember, you can always send me your emails to insideout@susanmadaris.com. I'm always looking forward to them. You can also follow me on Twitter for latest updates and discussions. Until next week and another show from all of us here in New York City, goodbye.